creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Good morning and welcome. It's great to have you all here, and it's lovely to see all your faces, even with the mask on, but it's such a joy. When we were all in lockdown, and when I sat to do my quiet time, I always like to praise God. And the old, I think it's a benediction, came to me, and it said, "Praise God from whom all blessings flow, praise him above all creatures here below." And it's just such a wonderful way to praise him. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And that's who we've come to praise and to worship this morning. So let's open in prayer. Open our eyes, Lord. Help us to see Jesus as he reaches out to heal our blindness. Help us to let go of all those things that keep us in darkness. This day, as your word is proclaimed, let our hearts and souls respond with joy. Transform our lives to do your will and bless our worship as we come before you today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Turned into wine, opened the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God turned into wine, opened the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater, healer, awesome in power.
The Old Testament reading is from Job 42, 1-6, and then 10-17. Then Job replied to the Lord, "I know that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. You asked, 'Who is this that obscures my plans without knowledge?' Surely I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. You said, 'Listen now, and I will speak. I will question you, and you shall answer me.' My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes." After Job had prayed for his friends, the Lord restored his fortunes and gave him twice as much as he had before. All his brothers and sisters and everyone who had known him before came and ate with him in his house. They comforted and consoled him over all the trouble the Lord had brought on him, and each one gave him a piece of silver and a gold ring. The Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the former part. He had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 donkeys. And he also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. The first daughter he named Jemima, the second Keziah, and the third Keren Huptu. Nowhere in all the land were there found women as beautiful as Job's daughters, and their father granted them an inheritance along with their brothers. After this, Job lived 140 years. He saw his children and their children to the fourth generation, and so Job died, an old man and full of years. Here ends the reading.
Our God. The psalm for today is from Psalm 126. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. Restore our fortunes, Lord, like streams in the Negev. Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. Those who go out weeping, carrying seed to sow, will return with songs of joy, carrying sheaves with them. The epistle reading is from Hebrews chapter 7, verses 23 to 28. Now there have been many of those priests since death prevented them from continuing in office. But because Jesus lives forever, he has a permanent priesthood. Therefore, he is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them. Such a high priest truly meets our need, one who is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above the heavens. Unlike the other high priests, he does not need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins and then for the sins of his people. He sacrificed for their sins once for all when he offered himself. For the law appoints as high priests men in all their weaknesses, but the oath, which came after the law, appointed the Son, who has been made perfect forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "Go," said Jesus. "Your faith has healed you." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road.
Let's pray. Lord God and Heavenly Father, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts will be acceptable to you, in Jesus' name. Amen. My message today is entitled Tackling Tribulation, Trials and Tests. And despite having a nice little bit of assonance, I found a message very difficult to prepare. And certainly what I'm saying here today, I'll be saying first of all to myself. And if you can pick up anything worthwhile, then that's a bonus. So, tackling tribulation, trials and tests. Now, during the recent lockdown, the blokes in the men's Bible study have been working our way through the book of Daniel. In this book, there are some of the most famous of Bible stories. Everyone knows the incident of Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego in the fiery furnace, not to mention Daniel in the lion's den. And of course, there is the incident of the writing on the wall. All of these stories, famous from Sunday school, all occur in Daniel. It's not too difficult to work out that these incidents are graphic illustrations of the power of the Lord of Heaven and compelling reminders that God is in control. He will save those who serve him, and he will condemn those who act against him. The fiery furnace illustrates that those who obey God, who obey God's will not be consumed by the fires of judgment. Daniel's adventure with the lion's den lets us know that those who put their trust in God will not be the victims of the devil, who prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. These are wonderful revelations because Daniel and his fellow Jews had been carried off into exile in Babylon. They had been taken far from home and held captive in the land of their enemies. To know that God is in control of events both on the individual level and on a more global scale must have been a great comfort to them, even though uncomfortable at the time. But there is more in Daniel. There are several chapters of visions and prophecies, and I must admit that it was challenging to work out their significance, not only to Daniel, but also their significance for us today. For example, one of the last of these visions is revealed over three chapters. In this vision, Daniel is given insight into the Book of Truth. This book is God's history of the world. And the interesting thing about this is that God's history looks forwards to what is to come rather than backwards to what has happened, the way historians in our world do it. And because God is in control of history, the events will happen because they have been decreed by him. So what is Daniel's reaction to these revelations? And there was more than one. What would your reaction be? Would you be grateful to know what to expect? Would you be excited to know what was going to happen? Would you be confident because you could take steps to get ready? Daniel's reaction was different. After one vision, he was troubled in spirit, and the visions that passed through his mind disturbed him. This same vision left him deeply troubled, and his face was pale. After another vision, he was exhausted and lay ill for several days. He was appalled by the vision. It was beyond understanding. Having been told that he was to see another vision, Daniel mourned for 3 weeks. And as the vision was being revealed to him, his strength left him, his face turned deathly pale, he was helpless, and in the end he collapsed. Further into this same vision, he was overcome with anguish, and he knew he was helpless. His strength was gone and he could hardly breathe. Thankfully, he was revived by God and strengthened by his words of encouragement. Peace, be strong now, be strong. And why was this? It's not explicit in the text why Daniel felt this way. However, it seems to me that being shown the history of the world to come, Daniel worked out that for his people, the Jews, the future would hold great tribulation. The Jews would return from exile in Babylon, but that return would be a painful one. They would return to a place that would not compare to the place that they had left. Israel, Jerusalem, and the temple would be mere shadows of their former greatness and glory. But that wasn't all. The future that was revealed in the Book of Truth was that successive powers would march through Israel on their way to war. From Alexander the Great, the armies of the kings of Egypt, the armies of the kings of Persia and Syria, even the Romans get a mention. For the next 400 or 500 years, Israel would be tortured by the chaos of the war that marched up and down their land. Daniel's vision provided a detailed description of what would happen. wicked kings would do wicked things, and Israel, the beautiful land, would suffer. More than this, the vision extended past these events. The history of the world, as revealed in the Book of Truth, would see continual chaos. The king who does as he pleases will reign. And this king, though he wasn't named, is seen by many as to be the Antichrist. There will be a time of distress as has not happened from the beginning of the nations until the end. In short, chaos will continue, and it will get increasingly worse until Judgment Day. On this day, multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth, those who are dead and buried, will awake, some to everlasting life, others to shame and to everlasting contempt. Whether we like it or not, tribulation, trial and testing are all part of our world, and we cannot escape them. It's not a pretty picture that was revealed to Daniel. No wonder he was brought to anguish. There is nothing he could do to change events. By a spiritual being, go your way, Daniel, because the words in the Book of Truth are closed up and sealed. They won't be changing until the time of the end. Many will be purified, made spotless and refined, but the wicked will continue to be wicked. None of the wicked will understand, but those who are wise will understand. Daniel could do nothing to change the course of events that God had set in place. He was helpless and powerless in the face of the chaos that surrounded him and would surround his people for centuries to come. We are in a similar position. We can do nothing to change the course of the river of time. But God can. A look at today's Bible passages shows us that in the face of continual trials, tribulations and tests that we will all face, both personally, locally, nationally, and globally, that God has done great things. That God has turned trials into opportunities to grow in grace. That God gives the blessings to see things as they really are. And God provides the way of escape. And I'll have a brief look at those, and hopefully we can find that there might be a way through tribulations. So the time is coming when the nations, in Psalm 26 we are told, the time is coming when the nations will recognise that the Lord has done great things for those who are his children, those who have called out to him and put their faith in Jesus, the Son of God. What are these great things? First and foremost, the greatest thing is that through the sacrifice of his Son, Jesus, God has provided the way of escape from the destructive forces of sin, death, and the devil. Jesus, through his death, has paid the penalty for our sins and satisfied God's justice. Jesus' blood spilt on the cross has washed us clean of guilt and shame and turned aside God's righteous anger, our righteous anger that we fully deserve. Through his death on the cross, we are no longer separated from the love of God. We can now, with confidence and joy, enter his presence. God has done great things for those who are his children. Psalm 126 talks of God restoring the fortunes of his people, and they respond with songs of joy. The great things God has done for us through Jesus the Christ have restored us to the glorious state that was lost when sin entered the world. Once we were like a desert, the Negev, where nothing would grow. But now streams of living water bring the desert to life. Once we found our work burdensome, but now we can reap the blessings of the Lord with songs of joy. What should we do when we face trials and tribulations? Look to the great things that God has done for us. And this brings events into perspective. As Paul puts it, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed to us. Secondly, let's consider Job. If anyone experienced tribulations, trials, and tests, it was Job. God was blessed by God and was prosperous. But trials, terrible trials, came upon him. Job lost everything he had: his wealth, his family, his health, his social standing. In all this, Job did not sin by charging God with any wrongdoing. Job, at the beginning of the book, seemed to have his life in order. But by the time we get to the end of the book, 40-odd chapters later, we find that Job has learned much. Job finds that God is greater than he thought. God can do all things, and no plan of his can be thwarted. Job also finds that he's not as clever as he thought he was. God asks him, "Who obscures my counsel without knowledge?" And Job can only admit that he spoke of things that he did not understand, things too wonderful for him to know. Or put another way, Job admits that his ears have heard of the Lord, but now he has seen God, he has been put in his place. Therefore, he despises himself and repents in dust and ashes. The trials he faced brought about a change in Job. He now knows God and himself better than he did before. He has grown in grace. And this has brought blessings to him, blessings that exceeded those that he had in the first place. Job's experiences show that James's words, though challenging, are not only true, but doable. And James says in chapter 1 of his letter, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking in anything." Next, the account of Jesus' meeting with Bartimaeus. And here we look at what one of the most clear-sighted of characters tells us. He's called blind Bartimaeus. In Mark's gospel, we find that Bartimaeus is sitting outside the gates of Jericho. He is blind, helpless, and beneath the notice of almost everyone. Bartimaeus may be blind, but he can see things more clearly than anyone else in the crowd. He has undoubtedly heard that Jesus is passing by, and he cries out to Jesus, the Son of David, to have mercy on him. He knows that from what he has heard, that Jesus is the promised one, the Messiah, the one who will sit on David's throne forever. Bartimaeus could see what the others couldn't, and in faith he called out, and Jesus heard his cry. Jesus asked him what he wanted. Bartimaeus replied that he wanted to see, and Jesus responded. Bartimaeus' faith healed him. He could see, and then he followed Jesus. Now, a little interesting sidelight to this, I recently purchased a new study Bible, just to give me hopefully more insights, and it's called the Christian Standard Bible. I'd never come across it before until I saw a video of the Bishop of South Sydney talking on the pastor's heart. They had a little row of the Bibles behind him, so I thought, oh, that might be interesting, so I bought myself a copy. And so far, so good. But this version translates verse 52 as, "Go," said Jesus, "your faith has saved you." Not "faith has healed you," as it says in the New International Version, but "your faith has saved you." Faith saves and faith heals. Is there a difference? Thankfully, I'm not a theologian and I don't need to answer that question. So there's no matter. The trial of Bartimaeus' blindness came to an end with faith and the blessing of sight that was added to his gift of insight. Bartimaeus was truly blessed. The fourth thing that God has done for us brings us full circle. God has provided the way of escape from the consequences of sin that have existed since Adam and Eve tasted the fruit of the tree of knowledge and good and evil. Trials and testing are constant reminders of these consequences, consequences that we can do nothing about, but God can. In the letter to the Hebrews, the writer tells us that Jesus is our great high priest, and he is far and away superior to the high priests that were appointed to serve in the temple and the synagogue and the tabernacle down through the centuries. The role of the high priest was to act as an intermediary between God and man. He offered sacrifices to atone for man's sin. He did this in the Holy of Holies once a year by sprinkling the blood of the sacrifice, of the animal sacrifice, on the mercy seat. Jesus is superior to this because he is high priest forever. After Jesus died and rose again, he ascended to the right hand of God and is able to save completely those that come to God through him, and he can intercede on their behalf. It reminds us that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and nobody comes to the Father but by him. Jesus' character is superior. The men who were high priests were mostly, but not always, men of sound character. But Jesus meets our needs because he is holy. He is blameless, without sin. He is pure. He is set apart from sinners, and he is exalted above the heavens. This is important because he does not have to sacrifice for his own sin, because he has no sin. He doesn't need to sacrifice for his own sin before he can sacrifice for the sins of others. And then his sacrifice is superior. The men who were priests offered animal sacrifices daily, as well as the yearly one the high priest offered. But Jesus, when he offered himself on the cross, sacrificed himself once and for all. Jesus was appointed high priest, not according to the law, but by the oath, the promise of God, to rescue, redeem, and restore sinners like you and me. It has been God, through Jesus Christ, his Son, who has provided the way of escape once and for all, and provided the wherewithal through the Spirit for us to continue or to endure the trials and tests that will inevitably come our way. How do we tackle tribulations, trials, and tests? The first thing we do is to realise that we can do nothing to prevent them from coming, nothing to avoid them, nothing to resolve them. The second thing to remember that God is in control and he has done great things for us. It is because God has done great things for us that we're able first to be saved and then to be preserved unto eternal life. That is, we are saved, and then through the process of sanctification, which so often is achieved through trials and tests, through this process, believers will become like him. We'll become more and more, will grow into his image. Daniel was cast into anguish at the thought of the difficult times his people would experience after seeing the history of the world laid out before him. Trials are indeed difficult, but when we see them as God-given gifts for us to grow in grace and through faith, then they can be endured to the glory of God. As I was laying in bed this morning pondering about these things, I was reminded of a test that I think Francis Schaeffer once said, having said this, how then should I live? And I asked myself, well, how should I live? Should I fear the future? Certainly not. I should look to the future with hope, the certain expectation that Jesus Christ will return to claim his own, and that I will live with him forever, come what may, that happens in this life, in this vale of tears, on this mortal coil. So be encouraged. Look with hope to the future in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Shall we close in prayer? Lord God and Heavenly Father, we do give you thanks. We do give you praise. We do recognize that you are indeed above everything that happens in this world, both individually, nationally and internationally. We pray, Lord, that as we do go through times of trouble, times of tribulation and times of difficulty, that you will remind us again and again that you are indeed Lord of all, and that when we look to you, these times of trouble and tribulation can be times of great growth for us, great thanksgiving, and that we can be and we can grow in grace through faith in you. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
My soul proclaims your greatness, Lord, rejoicing in my Savior. Your mercy belongs to those who fear your Son. His blessing you have given them forever. And holy is His name, holy is His name. You alone have done great things. I can't boast of anything. Mighty One, King of Kings, Jesus. Jesus.
Let us pray and give thanks now to our Lord. Lord God,
we give in grateful thanksgiving all that you have given us. In the upside-down world of the gospel, we measure our worth not by what we have, but what we can give away. Let us give away generously in this offering and in all we do to bless your church, your people, and your creation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The Lord said through Jeremiah that we are to proclaim, give praise, and pray for the salvation of others. So let us lift our hearts to God and ask him to bless those in need. Let's pray. Gracious Father, praise be to your blessed name for your mercy and kindness to us. You have come to us full of grace and truth. Before the foundation of the world, you chose us as your own to be holy and blameless in your sight. You predestined us to be adopted as your children through Jesus Christ. This was your pleasure and will, and we in turn thank and praise you. How wondrous is your holy church, composed of redeemed sinners like us. Bless your church, that she may shine with your Son's light in this world. Revive and refresh us by your Holy Spirit, so that we can confess your name before others, pray fervently for our neighbour, and demonstrate your love through good works. May we all speak your word in truth and power, and care for each other in the body of Christ. How blessed we are to enjoy the freedoms and prosperity of this country. Bless all the people of this land and all who lead our nation's affairs, in particular our Prime Minister, our premiers, our elected politicians, and our leaders in business and society. Give them a love of truth and justice. Help all citizens to serve their neighbour through their vocation. Help those who are unemployed or whose work is difficult or dangerous or stressful. Strengthen all families and the bond of marriage. Give all children and young people a renewed respect for their parents, and guide all parents in raising their children. How great is your power that you guide the nations of the world. Continue to curb evil and bring oppression to an end. Show mercy and give relief to those who have experienced natural disasters. Help them to rebuild in the wake of the destruction and comfort them with the consolation of your word. We also pray for the modern state of Israel and all who live in Palestine. You came to what was your own, but your own people did not receive you. Turn the hearts of the Jewish people to your Son, their Messiah, and help all Gentiles to bear witness to your love. We just pray for those listed here in the prayer book. We especially pray for Leslie Howes, and we pray that the doctors would be able to give her a correct diagnosis soon and continue treatment for her. We give thanks for Merrion, Peter, and all those involved in making those YouTube services for us. We pray for God's blessing on our new Bishop of the Lutheran Church of Australia, and we ask that you would give him the courage and the strength to make wise decisions in his leadership of us. And we also give you thanks, especially that we are now able to meet together again. And we pray for those who are on the front line of treating the COVID virus, the doctors, the nurses, the paramedics, all those who have given so much of their time, efforts, and we just give you so much thank for them. We also pray for those who are listed in our baptism list here. We pray for John Talbot, Kelsey Daniels, Joel Little, Olivia Road, Kathy Road, Amelia Kubeka. We thank you for these people, Lord, and we praise you that you have brought them into your kingdom through the gift of baptism. Loving Father, when blind Bartimaeus cried out to your son, his prayer was answered and he was healed. Hear our prayer this day and bless all those we have prayed for through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Close. Darkness has been banished, sight has been restored. Our lives are reformed in Christ's love. Go now in peace to serve with great joy. Take the love of God with you wherever you go, that the light which has brightened your life may shine for others. Go now to serve in peace and the strength of Christ. Amen.